I'm Jeremy Mahalik. I'm a professor in mechanical engineering and engineering in public policy. I run the vehicle electrification group. And Venkat Vishwanathan is also going to, co-hosting this event. We'll be leading the Q&A afterwards. Venkat's a battery guy, a fundamental science guy, and I'm more of a systems guy. And this is one of the themes in Steve's book, is about this tension and interaction between sort of fundamental science battery guys and kind of the system guys. So I thought that was appropriate. So Steve is a Washington correspondent at Quartz, which is the business news website of Atlantic Media Company. He writes about the intersection of energy, technology, and geopolitics. And he's a future tense fellow at the New America Foundation and an adjunct professor in security studies at Georgetown University. His newest book that he'll talk about today is The Powerhouse, which tracks the geopolitics of lithium-ion battery innovation. And he has two prior books on the oil and the glory and Putin's labyrinth. And he has experience over 18 years as a foreign correspondent for the Wall Street Journal, New York Times, the Washington Post. He was expelled from Russia and wounded in Chechnya, and he investigated a murder of a Wall Street Journal colleague, Daniel Pearl. So he's a tough guy. I'm sure he can handle us. He got a three-year fellowship from New America that helped him to be in the battery department at Argonne National Lab for a period of 2 years, which is where he gets part of the information for this book. And with that, everyone please welcome Steve Levine.
Thanks very much. So, thanks so much. Is the mic on? It's on. Great. Thanks so much, Venkat and Jeremy, for having me here at Carnegie Mellon. I got interested in batteries about 5 years ago. The situation, the environment for batteries is completely different now from when I started. When I started looking at the book, batteries were an aspiration. The United States and really countries around the world were just coming out of and off of the financial crisis, almost brought down. Remember when this exotic financial instruments created by Wall Street had almost brought down the global economy and triggered doubts, profound doubts in the United States and around the world about whether we could produce a real economy. Did we need exotic financial instruments, bubbles, real estate bubbles, tech bubbles, dot-com bubbles, in order to run a first-world economy? Or could we produce something real products that would drive big economies, create jobs, stable wealth, and so on? And the imagination of a lot of countries, including the United States, came to fixate on batteries. The creation of a super battery, a battery when you go into the drugstore or the supermarket and you buy a AA battery for your remote device, something five times as powerful as that, something that could power itself, be very powerful and be purchased, but could power whole new industries, electronic devices, of course, but electric cars. And the numbers that were thrown out by the folks who were looking at this new potential industries were thinking in terms of new Googles, Exxons, Panasonic's, worth tens and hundreds of billions of dollars a year over time, right, into the 2020s. When you looked at who was interested in getting into these fields, of course, President Obama was talking about it. Right? He had declared the United States is going to put 1 million electric cars on the road, America's roads, by the year 2015. And China said, Wang Gang, the Minister of Science and Technology. So, well, we're all, Obama is, well, we are too. We're going to put 1 million electric cars on our roads. We're going to do it first. France, UK, Germany, Israel, South Africa, Brazil, Argentina, it seemed any country, if you Googled electric car and or lithium-ion batteries and a country, something would come up. Everybody wanted to own this future industry, this forecast industry. Batteries, super batteries, or electric cars. And this is my whole thing that I'm interested in is how energy impacts geopolitics. How do changes in all forms of energy, old energy like oil and new energy like technology, how does that impact power and influence in the world? And when you looked at those forecasts and the idea that wealth of nations flows into power of nations, this looked like, right, if these new industries materialized, this is going to be either in entrenching, first of all, they would be real industries, entrenching existing incumbents. Is that for me? Okay. I'm not taking any calls right now. My phone may ring next.
That's true.
Or create new powers. Maybe there would be new superpowers. Great powers would emerge from that. And this was all aspiration. And this was started this race among nations to be first in batteries and electric cars. 5 years later, the aspirations still are there, right? There's some skepticism, of course. There's a lot of skepticism about electric cars, if this is a real industry, about batteries, if we can really create super batteries. But there is a full-fledged commercial battle underway right now that didn't exist in 2010. Wall Street Journal reported last week that Google has got a super-powered four-person team working on a super battery. And the guy running that team was the battery guru at Apple. And if anyone here has an Apple iPhone 6 or the 6 Plus, and it has that this new style of battery in it that makes the 6 Plus so powerful, that stacked lithium-ion architecture, it was invented by this fellow who moved over to Google. Apple has hired 1,000 battery guys, right? Poached them from other companies, and car experts. And Tesla is in this game. Samsung is in this game. The biggest, in other words, the biggest high-tech names on the planet, the companies with the most sizzle, who know how to invent new stuff, and as important, or perhaps more important, how to design products so people want to buy them, and know how to sell make a lot of money. They suddenly are all in this game. They're in the battery game. And this changes the environment. It changes the whole atmosphere around batteries. It means that we're onto something. Those in this room who are thinking about getting into the battery game, who are thinking about being battery guys, but incidentally, this term battery guys applies to men and women. And I didn't make up this term when I was at Argonne. So I sat at Argonne National Lab outside Chicago in its battery department for 2 years, fly on the wall watching their team of battery guys working on the super battery. They call themselves battery guys. And then the people who are alien from that, from their group, are not battery guys. And this is like the lowest thing you can say about someone. They're not he's not a battery guy. It sounds funny, but they really do that. This means that you working in this field and the folks who will and already work in the field of batteries are in a game that's really happening. What's going on is that these companies have become impatient. They become impatient with the battery guys, in labs, national labs, at universities, at startups in Silicon Valley. It's not happening fast enough. They need a super battery. Batteries have moved from wish we had to we really need the super battery, and they need them for their devices. These companies, Apple has got, not only does it earn a lot of money and sell hundreds of millions of devices, it's got $178 billion in the bank. It doesn't know what to do with this money. This is the surplus, right? To keep that machine going, the Apple machine going, and Tesla, right, for Elon Musk, and Google, it's Google Glass, and its future autonomous vehicles. They have to have a super battery. This is the big hurdle. They can invent the iPhone 7, right? Who here doesn't think there's going to be an iPhone 7, right? Of course there is, and then an 8 and 9, and all the way until eternity. But the hurdle to making those work, the new functionality, and Elon Musk to make his Model 3, right, that he intends to put out onto the market in 2018, he needs this super battery. So that's a much different situation, and we need a super battery. Not only the battery guys, not only companies need a super battery, we need one. Just ordinary people need that super battery. And who needs, if you care about CO2 emissions, for example, then you need a super battery. A super battery changes the game in terms of the emissions of gasoline burning engines. And if you care about geopolitics, the power that's in the hands of countries that don't always act in a way that's favorable to how Americans, for example, think that something should run. Russia, for example, and its economy that runs as a petrostate, all of Russia's power relying on the production of oil and natural gas, and some OPEC countries too, outsized power, all of it flowing out of the possession of oil. And the idea, this levels the playing field. You have a super battery that results in the consumption, demand for less oil than those countries that earn so much money, and again, whose power and influence flows from the sale of oil. They have less relative influence and power, and the countries that are consuming nations, European nations, United States, but also China, South America, other countries that don't have that oil, they have more relative power. So the big commercial stakes are huge, and environmental stakes and geopolitical stakes are very, very high. So what's preventing this new day? Why isn't there a super battery? What is the thing that has made it so hard? The battery, first battery invented in the year 1799, and here we are over two centuries later, and we still don't have a super battery. So I'm going to talk today a little bit about what those obstacles are, some of the obstacles, and then I'm going to roll into what are some solutions have presented themselves, and I'll go into that And then, but there'll be room, there's going to be time for there to be a fireside chat with a couple of your battery guys. And then we'll have questions, a lot of time for questions from you. And also we have a group potentially watching by webcam out in Silicon Valley, your remote campus out there. The main problem for batteries is the physics, right? So we have become accustomed in our age because of our daily practices and our interests, what we've grown up with, to put the battery in the same slot, in our same mental slot, as a smartphone, right? We think that because we get a new iPhone every other year, with all kinds of new devices, we think that because our grandmother, right, got a hip replacement, just as a routine surgery, that we ought to have a super battery. What's the problem? Why doesn't my iPhone last all day? Why doesn't it last 2 days? We think that because we're NASA is considering and Elon Musk is talking about putting a man on Mars, that we should have a super battery. If we can do all of these things, if we have a Voyager mission, we have two spacecraft, while we're speaking, traveling outside the solar system. What's the thing with batteries? Why can't we get there with, why have we not gotten there with batteries? There's something fundamentally different about the battery that separates itself from all of these other technologies, and that's that the stuff doesn't stay in one place. When you invent, for example, when your grandmother got that hip replacement, it put the hip there, and the next morning it was still there, and the next day it didn't move at all. When silicon engineers at Intel or wherever invented a new architecture for a chip that powered the next generation of the iPad or of the iPhone, when they finished establishing the architecture on that silicon chip, they didn't come back the next day, and all the atoms had shifted from their places and created, transmogrified into something else. But batteries do that. So I want to tell you a story about General Motors. So General Motors is a central actor in my book. They are a licensee of a very, very serious lithium ion chemistry that was invented by the battery guys who I profile in the powerhouse. This stuff is called NMC, and that's an acronym for the metals that are embedded in the cathode of the battery. GM back in 2010 licensed this chemistry, the NMC. And the reason they did that is because it had this phenomenal property. When there's a South African named Mike Thackeray who's at Argonne, he's one of the scientists. Back in 2000, he invented this stuff, NMC. It's a very, very good material. It's stable. It holds a lot of energy. Very, very good for electronic devices. But what Thackeray discovered one day, he heard there was a breakthrough made at Dalhousie University in Nova Scotia. A scientist up there took this NMC, the same stuff, and instead of using the usual voltage, applying the usual voltage to this chemistry, which is 3.7 volts, he upped the volts just to do so to 4.7 volts to this cathode. And this phenomenal, this fantastic result emerged. This cathode became ultra, the capacity of this cathode grew tremendously. And it became, the potential of this cathode created, it turned into something approaching this much better battery that everybody wanted. And GM wanted this. This was a way for GM to move toward its aspiration, which was to have a 200-mile car, a car that would travel 200 miles on a single charge. It was a big, you know, a big announcement was made. It was very, very public. We've licensed this stuff. So not long after that, Thackeray was at a battery conference out in Vancouver, and he's approached by the CTO, the chief technology officer of a startup, A123, if anyone's heard of that, and who said to Mike, you know, have you checked the voltage chart on the NMC 2.0? I call it NMC 2.0. They don't call it that. Have you checked the voltage chart? It's unstable. Right? It's going haywire. And Thackeray was like deer in the headlights because he had not checked the voltage chart. This was not something that you ordinarily look at when you're a battery guy and you're checking and you're measuring your batteries. What happened with the NMC was that when you apply that 4.7 volts, you got that phenomenal capacity. But the next thing that happened is that everything shifted places. The cobalt went over here. The manganese went over there, the nickel went up, the oxygen was all over the place. It was as though, just for those who are not technical in the room, it is as though, this is an apt analogy, it is as though you go home tonight, you drive home tonight, and you approach your front door, but the front door isn't there, it's in the attic. And your living room is in the bathroom, and your driveway is in the kitchen. This is the material that Thackeray made, transmogrified into something completely different. And this means this made it unacceptable, unusable in an electric car. The material that GM had licensed specifically to power a 200-mile vehicle had transmogrified. The atoms wouldn't stay in the same place. And the challenge with that NMC that the battery guys are attempting to do, that they've been attempting to do, and they continue to attempt to do, is to get those atoms to stay in the same place. This is fundamentally different from silicon wafers. Just two little, very, very brief, other brief examples of what happens inside the batteries. Another answer that's raised, how do we create the super battery, is in the other electrode, right? Two electrodes in a battery, not the cathode, the anode. Let's make the anode out of silicon. Silicon has got potentially much better performance than graphite, which is the current anode. So this is it's tried around the country. The trouble with silicon is that when the lithium is inserted into the anode made of silicon, it expands by four times its size. Again, going back to the analogy, driving up to your home, and suddenly it has swelled up, and now it occupies your neighbor's lot to the left and right and to the back, and also swelled up double, you know, triple its size up as well. A third answer, lithium metal. Instead of just embedding limited particles of lithium into a battery. Let's just put pure lithium metal inside the battery. That gives you all the juice that you need for the super battery. The trouble with lithium metal, however, is that as soon as it's in contact with air, it catches fire. Right? So how do you, and this again is unacceptable. Right? One of the red lines for drivers around the world, doesn't matter what country you're from, you will not buy a car if, when you're driving it, it catches fire. So this also is one of those challenges that that's out there. So I want to throw out this other thing with the challenge is so great, it being so very hard to create the super battery, but on the other side of the ledger, the stakes being so high in terms of what we want, and the payoff so big in terms of making a lot of people really rich, you get this phenomenon that's this outsized phenomenon in batteries more so than in other technological fields. You get liars. What you get is you get battery inventors who greatly exaggerate what they can do, what they have done, and it's an unfortunate aspect to the battery field. Everyone in this room certainly has heard month by month, or maybe every few months, if you're not paying close attention, a huge battery breakthrough, right? That's going to revolutionize the world, but then you never heard about it again. It's because those guys made it up. Right? This is the they don't make up the whole thing, right? There's a kernel of truth always to it, but a lot of what you hear in batteries is just not true. It's just not true stuff. And I have a personal experience in this one part. Not that I made something up, but. In my book, the company one of the companies I profile, it's a main actor in the book, is a startup out in Silicon Valley called Envious Systems. And so I had two threads in the book, Argonne National Lab, and they're trying to fix this problem of the atoms going all haywire. And then I've got this startup out in Silicon Valley that had licensed this material from Argonne and was attempting to optimize it and then sell it to GM to power that 200-mile electric car. And it was a very, very highly publicized company. It was in all the newspapers, New York Times, I mean, name it. It was publicized there. At ARPA-E in Washington, it was promoted widely. GM did license it, and the idea was that GM in 2016 next year was going to have its 200-mile electric car, and the NVIDIA guys were going to IPO for $1 billion. This was the thing, and this was the big finish in my book. Right, start out with the aspirations 2010 and finish with $1 billion IPO, and so I'm 3/4 of the way writing. The book, I've done all the reporting, I'm just writing. The book is due on January 1 last year. And in September, I get a phone call from someone at NVIDIA who I've been speaking to. We don't have what we said that we had. The whole thing had been exaggerated. They had not achieved the milestones that they claimed at all, and given an opportunity by GM 6 more months to demonstrate what the company had claimed in its slides when GM licensed it, could not repeat those performances. So it is a phenomenon in that's another problem along with the physics. It's our human frailties. You've got to be very careful when you're following the battery field. So, so where do we go from here? If it's so hard, if it's not like silicon, if it's not like going to Mars, what is it like? Has anyone here ever heard of Fermat's last theorem? Yeah. So for those who have not, 350 years ago, this fellow Fermat, he was a mathematician, and in his day was the most accomplished mathematician, and he posed in the margins of one of his papers that his son published after he was dead a theory, and for the next 350 years, mathematicians around the world had been vexed. It was like this very famous puzzle, labyrinthine puzzle of solving Fermat's last theorem. It's like a holy grail. In 1993, a guy named Andrew Wiles of Britain, after sitting for 7 years in his attic, announced in a symposium, a three-day symposium in Britain, that he had solved Fermat's last theorem. And that's what batteries are. Batteries are that kind of, on that order of a problem. It's an incredibly convoluted, very difficult puzzle that will be solved. And I think Venkat here is going to solve it. I mean, he told me today he was. He didn't really. He didn't say that. but it's of that level. And I think that when the super battery comes, that's what is going to create such a noise in the world that you will get maybe as big of a splash as Andrew Wiles did. But there's not only in terms of trying to solve the quest for the super battery. There's not only one pillar, the discovery in the lab. There are two pillars, and that's manufacturing. How you make the battery. So, Elon Musk, the CEO of Tesla, publicly has stated he doesn't believe in this quest. He doesn't believe that there's going to be, at least soon, at least in reasonable time, an answer to the super battery. He uses in his Tesla Model S and the Roadster and the X that's coming out later this year, ordinary off-the-shelf Panasonic batteries. They're very, very similar to the AA batteries that you use in your remotes. It's called a 18650. It's a little bit bigger than the AA, 8,000 of those. 8,000 of those are arrayed in the floorboard of the Model S, and his idea is, I'm not even gonna waste my time in the lab trying to create a super battery. I'm gonna engineer the heck out of these existing batteries, and I'm gonna engineer the rest. I'm gonna install this management system so they don't catch fire, and I'm gonna install every gizmo that anyone could ever want in the car, and I'm going to make it really cool to look at, go really fast. And he's validated. He single-handedly has validated this new age of the electric car. And now he's announced, I'm going to double the whole capacity. Not only do I believe in these off-the-shelf batteries, I'm going to build one gigantic new battery factory that in one place in Nevada doubles the entire global production capacity of lithium-ion batteries. He calls it the Gigafactory. I'm going to build this new battery. They're using these manufacturing techniques, and through that process, I'm going to reduce the cost, already my low costs of manufacturing, by 30%. more, and then I'm going to bring the electric car to the masses. I'm going to produce a car that goes 200 miles on a single charge and costs $35,000. So I was pretty, so John Goodenough, who's the father of the lithium-ion battery, everyone in here in this room who has a smartphone or who has a laptop, this laptop right here and that one, they all have a cathode, the nervous system of the battery, that John Goodenough invented. He's 92 years old, he's still inventing. He's absolutely scornful of Elon Musk and this whole thesis that he doesn't believe in the super battery. Goodenough still believes in the super battery. But whether or not you do or not, the other pillar of getting there, you can get there, the goal, forget the super battery and where it can bring you. The goal, right, is to have a car that goes some distance. We don't know. You don't know. You know, we can all take a guess. If I asked for the number of miles that you need to feel comfortable driving an electric car that you don't have range anxiety, people have different, you know, 100 miles, 200 miles, 300 miles. I need to know that charge will take me that far without recharging, or I'm not buying the car. But 200 miles, this is pretty far. Reasonable people can agree that's not a pittance. That's a reasonable distance. And $35,000. So I bought for my family a new car that cost $35,000. And it turns out that's the average. Americans last year paid $34,995 on average for their new vehicles last year. So that's the price that Elon Musk, and by the way, the BMW, the low-end BMW Series 3, it costs $35,000. It's kind of a sweet spot. And so if you can manufacture your way to that spot, take your battery as far as you can. The newest commercial chemistry that exists right now, plus, you know, engineer out every inefficiency on the factory floor. Get all of your supply lines together in one place, and you might be able to get to that same goal. And it turns out that we are approaching that. We are approaching an inflection point for these very reasons. So I mentioned Musk's Model 3. This is his 200-mile car, which he says that he's going to launch. He's going to put on the market in 2018. He's always late. Right? So maybe it'll be 2020, but somewhere, right? 2018, 2020. And GM, a few weeks ago at the Detroit Auto Show, it unveiled the Bolt, the pure electric Bolt. And this is its 200-mile car. After it had its fiasco with Envia, LG, the South Korean company, it used this method that Musk talked about, the engineering method. It took the NMC, the argon material, and it managed to re-engineer it and make it much more powerful, much more usable and stable. And it has created a battery that can take a car to 200 miles. That's at the heart of the GM car. Apple. Wall Street Journal has reported that Apple intends to create a car called the Titan, and it's hired these 1,000 battery guys and car guys to help put that together. This is a report. Apple is extraordinarily secretive, so we don't know that it actually will, but I think it will. And the reason that I think it will is that autonomous driving, the biggest new technological play in the world right now, is the coming age of autonomous functionality in cars. Tens of billions and hundreds of billions of dollars that will be earned when your car parks itself, when you can summon your car. Let's forget the far-fetched stuff that you just close up the car and push the button and suddenly you're in Milwaukee. I have my doubts about that, but the functionality, these autonomous functionality, Google, Apple, the car, GM, name your car, Audi, Porsche, all of them Ford, they want to own this future. They all have set up shop in Silicon Valley. They already have some of this autonomous functionality in their cars. They all have learned from Elon Musk. They want to have technology on wheels. And the money that Apple earns from selling, tens of millions of dollars, tens of millions of units of smartphones will be not peanuts, but will be smaller from this new market in autonomous vehicles. And so they're autonomous, but they're also electric, right? So all of these signs that we're seeing right now, Google, Apple, Tesla, all of them getting into the battery game, into the electric car game, and these car companies all setting up in Silicon Valley, and this autonomous future, this is all validation. And the years, the inflection point is near. It's the 2018 to 2020 time period. This is the beginning of this new period, of this new electric age. And I say that as I attempt to be a reasonable man. The sensibility in my book is I'm not a gee whiz guy. I don't throw out stuff that is meant to have parenthetically if the GM did unveil the Bolt, right? The 20 that it intends to put onto the market in 2018. Elon Musk does have a record, even though he's late, of putting his cars onto the market in a way that people really want. Google does have an autonomous vehicle that is seen driving around San Francisco, and Apple has hired 1,000. This is not a small number of specialists. And so I do think, just to close out, we are going to get there. It's going to be slow going. The first models off the mark are not going to take us right into the age when it's the age meaning that everyone in this room can own an electric car. All of those markers that I described in the beginning that were part of the aspiration that we began with in 2010. We don't get to all those places right away. But the beginning, we're in the valley of death right now. If you can survive these 3 years as a company, as a country, then in about 2018, that's the beginning of the real race. Thank you very much.
So the format that we adopt for the Q&A, Jeremy and I will lead with some questions. Then we'll pull some of the questions that we're getting on Twitter already. And then maybe we'll pass the mic around, have a couple of questions from the audience. We have some time to chat, so. And those that haven't read the book, buy one, or Carnegie Library has several copies. Just check that there are five that are still available.
Buy one. He meant okay. Buy one.
I meant buy one. Okay. So the first one, first question I thought, after I read the book, you know, I know a whole bunch of characters in the book, so I decided to ask them what they thought about the book. And so through this Q&A, I'll probably pose some of the statements and then questions based on that. Brad Ulrich, who gets a one-line mention in the book, I used a thrill for that one-line mention. He said, Levine captured rather accurately a time in our lives that was undoubtedly very stressful. But we moved on from that. Do you still keep in close contact with the folks from the hub? And do you think you know, their lives have moved on? And how is the hub doing?
First of all, Brad is a very nice guy. Brad Ulrich is a lawyer. He's an IP lawyer, and he's the lawyer for the hub. What I think they've moved on from is talking to journalists. I mean that serious. I think that there's some regret. I don't think there should be, but. Along with the thrilling stuff, which really was for me thrilling, even though they wondered the whole time and asked me, are you really going to be able to produce a book out of this? But there are moments that one might be embarrassed about. But we all have, right? We all have moments like that. So I don't think, I think they should be okay about it. But they're very, very sensitive people. So the hub is two and a half years in. And when I honestly, when I ask them how they're doing, I say, will you have, right? At the end of 5 years, they're supposed to have this world-shaking invention. They say, we'll have at least one. But when you ask, right, for specifics, there isn't a specific. And so let's see. Let's see how they do.
Okay, so just following up on that, actually Yetming Chang also made that same statement that some of the parties that are mentioned in the book no doubt wish that they'd kept quiet. How did you get these academics to open up, especially those in the national labs?
Yeah. So There are, among scientists, there are different characteristic personalities. For example, geologists are just chatterboxes. Battery guys are not at all. And it's very, 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 very hard to, you know, to get them to open up. And I also think that there's something about those who work for the Department of Energy. They're financed by the government, and they're I don't know what they're afraid of, but they feel like the earth is going to consume them if they tell me their middle name, for example, or something, you know. And I spent a lot of time there. You know, if you have someone sitting in the room all the time while you're working, at first you can attempt to, you know, censor yourself, control what you're doing, but after a while you forget that the person was there. And there were a number of moments where I just slipped into a room, I'm sitting in the room, and then after a half hour, 4 to 5 minutes, or an hour, hey, wait a second, Steve's here. Yeah. I did give everyone the option while we were speaking, that if there was something ultra, ultra personal that they didn't want me to use, that I wouldn't. And there are a number of times where that was invoked. Just stuff that I wish I could have used, but that I couldn't. So they knew what could go into the book.
So let me ask one question. So there's a lot of lying, stealing, cheating, and hype portrayed in the book, and it paints a certain picture of the
the process of innovation. And so I'm interested in that. I wanted to like poke a couple things out of the book and then ask you this question. So one of the things was I thought was apt was this quote from Thomas Edison from 1883 that says, just as soon as a man gets working on the secondary battery, it brings out his latent capacity for lying. And there's a quote from Gallagher mentioning that, from Kevin Gallagher at Argonne National Labs, mentioning that ARPA-E as a whole, with its pressures to deliver big leaps, was basically set up for companies to lie. And something you see in the book is this tension between the folks working at the lab, some of whom are really pushing on, we need to be as honest as we can, or else we'll never make progress, and the startups who need to sell something that they may have not even achieved yet. I guess what I'm wondering is, having seen all of this, how do you see this? What's the healthy part of this in the innovation space? The battery people can be a little bit too conservative, maybe never push their ideas onto the market in the labs. The startup people end up lying and collapsing deals sometimes. So how does this get negotiated?
This is a great question. I'll take a stab at it. I don't think that anyone really knows what the ideal formula is, but something that happened in the book that I thought was very productive, very constructive, was a point at which the main actors in the lab, and I think in the battery community around the world, understood that everything that they were doing was wrong. That there was no technology, no idea on which anybody was working that was going to get them there to the promised land. And we need to start over again, right? The idea, we need to start over again. I think that's very healthy, and that you just don't see in our lives very much. Someone or an entity, imagine Microsoft saying publicly, we're a failure. We're going to start over again, and of course it is a failure, right? It's out of so many the most growing fields. And as far as I know, I'm just checking this today, they're not in batteries. They're not part of the battery game. So that's healthy. Another thing that's healthy is systems. I mean, this will play right into your field. The idea of not inventing a cathode or an anode or an electrolyte, but a system, right? That everything has to work together. Until recently, there was no coordination among the inventors of the three main components of the battery, and something away from some way to incentivize performance versus patenting and production of papers. So rather than having a great achievement on your resume that I wrote this paper, I got this patent, of having achievement measured by working on something that has a big practical result. Yeah.
No. I'll pull a question from Twitter, and just a reminder, tweet with the hashtag LeVineChat for getting your questions in here. You compared inventing the super battery to solving the Fermat's last theorem, which I think was a great analogy. From that picture, then is it that a super small stealth mode startup has some advantages from a large consortium-based model for doing things? This is a question from Ramya. That are there any specific differences in approach between the two that favor the small or the large?
It really depends who you're talking to. So just in the lab, Jeff Chamberlain, the main character in the book, who's in charge of the battery team, he favors the big consortium and teams. Great invention happens in teams, he says. Mike Thackeray, absolutely dead set against coming anywhere near a team. He's the inventor of the NMC, and says, you know, some people need to be by themselves, and they'll just get lost in a team. And also argues, who's going to give up if I invent the NMC and then I take it into this group, it'll just get lost. I'll never see it again. That sort of impulse. I think it takes all kinds. It should be open to all kinds. And we have no idea where the super battery is going to come from. So we need to not be one size fits all. But that stealth, I've also learned that as soon as you're stealth, it increases the tendency to fib. Right? There's something about the battery guys, when they were warning me. They didn't know for sure, but they were alerting me all the way along. Where is NVIDIA's data? Why don't they show us something? They don't have to tell us what chemistry they're using. Why aren't we seeing more of their stuff publicly? As soon as your stuff is not aired, you haven't produced something that's been vetted by your peers, it makes you guys, battery guys, suspicious.
Yeah. It's actually really apt, given the follow-up to the Andrew Weil story is that he came up with the first proof in 93, which turned out to be flawed.
Right.
And then he required this external vetting and actually had to collaborate with the external world for 2 years to fix the proof. So I think there's probably something to be learned from that. I'll just follow up on one of the questions that Jeremy asked about this lying business. Do you think there's something unique about the battery that brings out the lying more so than other industries? Is it because of the complexity of the device and complexity in how you report the performance? Or you think it's sort of across the board? I mean, it's there in all sectors.
Do you mean that do batteries attract liars?
Something along those lines. Or is it just across the board, startups all over it? There's nothing special about batteries.
Yeah, no, there is exaggeration in all fields. In my field, right? What is this fellow's name? This TV fellow who just got
Brian Williams
ousted for making up that he had been in this war situation. Every field has its hucksters, its exaggerators, its dead wood, but batteries are a special province of these character traits, and it's because it's so hard and because the stakes are so very high. These two things together, and it just means you have to be very cautious about what you're. I almost don't write anything about when I hear an announcement. I almost never write about it because I've become so gun shy.
Yep.
Yeah.
Maybe we'll take a couple of questions from the audience.
I'm not a battery guy.
I think, are we going to have a microphone?
A drug problem, the drug development, incredibly complex, can't be modeled. So what they've done is they use micro wells and they do massive high put screening with drug leads. So I'm just wondering, I've always been curious, if I was going to attack this problem, I'd try to develop mini micro batteries in 96 well plates and then put a different electrolyte, just by random chance, look at hundreds of thousands of leads, the way the pharmaceutical guys look at drug leads. Is that possible with batteries? Has that been done? Just totally curious.
Yeah. The Edisonian approach, this sort of trying every possible way of shifting the type of transition metal put in the cathode, in what proportion has been that has been the method that's gone that's taken us this far, and where we're at right now is a belief, pretty much a consensus, that it isn't going to get us the rest of the way, and that it needs to be something more systematic. And there are a couple of pathways that are being taken to answer your question and to be more systematic. And one of them is what's being done at the hub, and that's trying to get back to the basics, to the physics. This problem is so pernicious that battery guys don't really even know how the lithium ion battery really works. All they know is that it does work. And so the idea of getting down to the atomic level and understanding the role of every single thing in the battery, this is one of the answers. And the other one is a method that actually is being tried here, and it's being tried in other places, and that's creating a library, just a granular library, and they're calling it here's Venkat over here, genome, materials genome of every material possible that can be used in a battery, and how it works and what its impact is. And somehow, if you can put these two things together, it takes a long time, but it's the Bell Labs approach, and maybe you'll get there that way.
I am a battery guy, unabashedly. And
are you a liar?
I am known to stress for good reason. No, my question actually is more about the other half of what makes a battery super, and that's the economics. And a lot of what is presented in the book and talked about today is focused on some remarkable performance attributes. And I propose to you that to some extent we already have the performance needed for a quote-unquote super battery. You can indeed put a 200 or 300 mile battery in a vehicle that will even transport multiple people within that vehicle. They'll be satisfied with that particular performance, but it will cost them, well over $10,000 for that battery pack. And it could be just as much about reducing the cost and maintaining existing performance as it is about some astronomical quantum leap in performance. And the reason I'm going at this is that if you have a quantum leap in performance that really does suggest that you have a wholly different cell architecture or a wholly different manufacturing approach, and those things are so capital intensive and so difficult to create at the scale necessary that we're at minimum a decade away. If I or anyone or Venkat brought and put on the table and said, this is your super battery, it's 10 years probably before it's hard enough to go into a vehicle. So, and that's a very difficult thing for North American investors to deal with ever. So I guess I'm just curious what your take is on the economic side of it.
Yeah, well, thank you for that question. The cost is the holy grail, right? Because the Tesla Model S 85 version does go 285 miles on a single charge, but it costs $105,000. I know because Venkat owns one, and he told me that. Okay, but how do you make that car cost $35,000? This was the idea of that other pillar. Musk has said, I'm going to get there through manufacturing, through the gigafactory. So that's what it's somewhat what you're describing. What I wonder, does he really get down to $35,000? Does it look like a Tesla? We'll know in 2018.
Right. I mean, I guess one way to couch this there's a race on the technical side and a race on sort of the brute force cost down. Use our existing manufacturing paradigm or existing material paradigm with an optimization, which you mentioned. I'll put a shout out to Jay, who's one of the theme of the class that some of my students are involved with. They're trying to figure out if this is legit or not. Like, can they actually hit those numbers? Is it possible if you really do a front-to-back manufacturing assessment? I'm still not sure that they can, but it's possible maybe. So.
Right, but if you're not reducing the cost through in invention and you're not reducing it in manufacturing, those are the, as far as I know, those are the only two ways you can go.
Supply chain play as well. Good sourcing at massive quantities, and you could also in-house all of your active material production, for example. I mean, the current model for lithium-ion battery production is, you know, a distributed one where the active materials are sourced typically. If you bring all that in-house in one location, there is some economy of scale and cost down possible, but the question is, will it take you to the right point? And I think that's an open one.
I'll pull another question from the Twitter. Florrie Summer asks, are there big advantages of recharging speed for the super battery? And who are the people that are working on improving the recharging speed?
Yeah, this is another, right, so you get a super battery, or somehow you get the costs down, but it takes 10 hours to recharge a battery. It's another hurdle that that battery guys or the folks working on batteries, the technologists, have to cross. People aren't going to wait that long. Even if you can go 300 miles, you know, maybe, you know, you'll stop at a station and, you know, you use the bathroom and then you buy a candy bar. But that's about as long as you want to wait, you know, 20 minutes. You know, but maybe what we end up doing is the model of battery exchange. This is one of the things that Musk suggests. Yeah.
I'll pull one more and then go back to the audience. Vyas asks, what's the future of electric batteries for autonomous cars? You touched upon this a little bit during your talk, but is there anything radically different about designing batteries for autonomous vehicles versus ones that have people driving them?
I think the challenges are greater. The demands on that battery, or those batteries that are in that car, are going to be much greater. Think about when you're using your iPhone and you turn on the GPS, you can watch the level just plunge. And basically, if you do that for an hour, there's no juice left. So if you're doing that in your car, they really require some real performance improvement.
So this is now the computation that's required for the autonomous vehicle. That's going to be a huge power sink in addition to just pushing the car.
Basically. Oh yeah, yes.
I think sort of the story I've heard for at least the EV has been sort of the top-down approach, the Tesla model of let's make a super sexy luxury car that costs a lot of money and then let's see if we can get the cost down. I think the opposite case would be let's make the cheapest car we can that has really bad performance and let's see if we can just get it a little bit better over time. And I mention that because that's sort of what's happening in China is a lot of the EVs over there at this really low speed, or we already have electric bicycles, and there's hundreds of millions of them in China, but for example, the Chery QQ is one of the most top-selling EVs, and it uses a lead-acid battery. So, you know, 10 years from now, you might have a car that only goes 100 miles, but it costs $6,000, and that might actually sell here for some people, maybe college students. So thoughts on that approach, which is coming from the other side of the world.
Is this a question, or
yes.
It's a statement? It's okay to have a statement.
What are your thoughts on that approach? Because the only sort of approach I've heard is this, like, can we get the cost down from the top down?
Yeah.
You, in talking to anybody, has anyone ever thought about this sort of reverse approach?
Yeah, well, I think that's what most of the car, that's what the Leaf is, that's what the, you know, you may be talking about $10,000 car. I have two thoughts about that, and one is that on one level it is being tried here, but those cars end up being have ended up being, when you look at the list of sales list, they're not big sellers. I mean, they're small, very, very small sellers. And they could, in some parts of the world and in some urban areas, end up selling. But in most, I think most of the United States, at least, they're not going to move the needle. Look at who you particularly are and the people who you grew up with and who you know. Americans grow up wanting certain kinds of cars. There's a reason. What is the top five selling vehicles in the United States? All of them are big pickup trucks. And this is, so we want to go fast, we want to go far, we want to make a lot of noise. Tastes will have to change for that kind of a vehicle really to take off here.
We take one last question from the Twitter and then try to close. Kelvin asked a very interesting question. Do you think journalists are the main contributors to the lying problem?
Now, my question, does he mean generally or just about batteries? I think that in batteries and in technology as a whole, that there is a problem in journalism, and it's on a couple sides. One is just being gullible and not having either the technical knowledge to assess what they're really hearing, but also being starstruck, right? I'm appalled quarter by quarter when I watch these big town hall meetings in Silicon Valley with Tim Cook or Elon Musk, and these wide-eyed, beatific faces, as though they're standing before God himself, as all we're talking about is a device, right? A technology, and these stories are written that way. And I think that that most of the journalism about technology, about devices, about some scientific advances, not when you get into the deep stuff, but run-of-the-mill stuff, has this gee whiz quality that it detracts from a real understanding and a real appreciation both of those technologies, and the stakes are world. Having a realistic appraisal of what's possible, where we should go. And I think that it also contributes to the reverberation that goes the other way, and that's this malaise, this deep skepticism among big parts of the population about science, about technology, who just don't believe anything. So in short, just to summarize there, I think that the answer would be yes, that there is a role played by the messengers.
I'll close with the last question. Yeping Chan, who founded A123, who finds a prominent place in your book, he tells you that you're not done writing about batteries. Is this true? So us battery guys can watch what we say.
I'm writing about you. I'm not, so I do continue to follow the field. I continue to be interested in it, and let's just say that I have a big project coming up. I'm not that it would be uncompetitive to sort of spill it right out here, but there's something very interesting. Something that is interesting and that's potentially game-changing.
All right, so we close there. Thanks to Steve for coming out and entertaining us.
Thank you for having me.
Quartz Institute, Debbie and Kelly, and all the folks that have made this happen. Thanks.
Okay.
Nice. Thanks.
Thanks.